Welcome to The Record Show, your virtual spin around the vinyl industry. Brought to you by Radio Wasteland Records. Yes, Midland has a record store. Here's your host, Jim Gleason.
Greetings from the Wasteland and welcome to another edition of The Record Show. And we've got a great one headed your way today. We'll check in with Ken Norton from Ingram Entertainment to get caught up on all of the new releases headed your way via an indie record store near you. And we'll take a spin from the Wasteland that crosses over with a Discogs quick tip. Actually, it's more of a Discogs observation than anything, but we'll take it as it is. But first, a while ago, you may remember that I'd said once in a while you're going to hear a segment starting off with, I was going through a crate of records the other day. Well, I was going through a crate of records the other day here at the store when I came across this very, very interesting item. Now, at first glance, this appears to be some sort of white label promo from Capitol Records promoting their April 1974 product. But once you take a closer look, it's anything but. First off, the disc itself is heavier and feels more fragile, almost like an old shellac. And then the backside is completely blank. No etchings, no pressing, no audio whatsoever. So that got me thinking this very well could be something called an acetate. I called up our friend Steve Bales, who's quite the expert on these as well, and he agrees that this very well could be a rare acetate record. Now, technically speaking, I know that this isn't an acetate proper. What this is, though, is something called a lacquer cut, and that's an important part of the vinyl pressing process. And sometimes lacquer cuts, or in this case referred to as acetates, were used as either transcriptions or as promotional or as test records to do a final check of the audio, if you will, before a record goes to mass pressing.
Sounds by Howard Roberts is the kind of an album a lot of MOR and jazz programmers are looking for.
Other indications that this is a lacquer cut, or acetate, come from the album jacket itself. I have no reason to doubt that this is the original, especially when you look at some of the prints on the side, including this note to say take caution, because the thread cut from all professional quality recording discs is highly inflammable. Now, we think that this record was cut specifically for internal use at Capitol Records, whether it was for executives listening to check to see what they wanted to release in this particular month, or maybe they were just showcasing these artists internally to other record executives.
Howard Roberts recorded a string of hit albums for Capitol, and he still has a unique touch with a song, as his new album proves.
Another indication that this was not meant for radio airplay in the promotional side of things is that the announcer refers to one of the artists by their name, SNFU, but using that F word.
A group from England bringing influences from five other groups, including Procol Harum and Ginger Baker's Air Force, is SNAFU. You know, situation normal, all fucked up.
Now, as far as the rarity of this particular record, it does not exist in the Discogs database. I also had trouble finding any information online regarding this particular release. So when we put this into Discogs, as far as that database is concerned, this is a one of a kind. That in and of itself makes it a very collectible record, regardless of whether the artists contained on it are in demand or not.
Cockney Rebel's debut album, The Human Menagerie, is on EMI. The folks who gave us
Ooka Chaka, Ooka, Ooka, Ooka Chaka, Ooka, Ooka.
And now, from the makers of Lifeboat, Dream Kid.
So lay down your love.
Now, if anyone watching has ever seen anything like this, please leave a comment below. I'd be very interested to see if this indeed was something used internally at Capitol Records in the 70s.
Do you love you till the want-to's out of me?
Freddie, bless his heart, completes our April product slideshow without the slides presentation.
Time once again on The Record Show to check in with Ken Norton from Ingram Entertainment for our weekly update on all of the new and cool releases headed our way and headed to an indie record store near you. Ken, how are you today?
I'm doing well, Jim. How are you?
Good, thank you. It's a big week, is it not?
There's plenty coming out this week. Yeah. It certainly is. I'd say perhaps the biggest of the of everything is the Neil Young Shakespeare release. This was something he recorded at the Shakespeare Theater in 1971. And it was right after the Gold Rush album. So that's a very kind of key period in the Neil Young repertoire. It was filmed for a German television show and archived away. And Neil has pulled it out and is just saying what a fantastic recording this is all the way around. And, you know, Neil Young fans will definitely want to check this out. Even though there's been a lot of Neil Young reissues from his archives lately, this is supposedly one of the best sounding, sort of also in the kind of a key period of time that people love.
Looking forward to that one. It's going to be a biggie, hopefully.
Yeah, that's a good one. You've got a some reissue-y kind of things. You got Badfinger, No Matter What, sort of a best of on red, white, and blue vinyl, kind of a Union Jack kind of look that is pretty darn cool. Also, Panic at the Disco, their Death of a Bachelor LP, is being reissued on its anniversary and on a silver vinyl. And of course, they are just a big deal for sure. Spoon, Give Me Fiction.
Okay.
That album reissued on red and white vinyl this weekend. I think those are the highlights of, you know, the original Boston album is now available widely again on black vinyl. It's been available in some other forms for a while, but just as it's just regular, regularly available black vinyl at a regular price, that's returning to the shelves now.
Okay. And the Fleetwood Mac rumors phenomena continues. We've been talking about this for a couple of weeks now, but that's still mystifying. I think we went through 8 copies here last week.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It just keeps marching on. There's no stopping it. Of course, it's a classic record, and my understanding is the pressing is one of those, you know, that the audiophiles will say, you know, this is a quality pressing. It's definitely sounds great. You know, kind of no miss kind of purchase if you haven't already bought it. Come see Jim.
All right. We appreciate it. All right. Well, thank you very much, Ken. I hope you guys have a great week and stay spinning.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Panic of the Disco, Death of a Bachelor, the 5th anniversary album is coming out this week with a special release. The album is silver, so not this very fancy regular old black that I have. This is the first album that Panic of the Disco released where basically Brendon Urie is the only one in the band. So Panic of the Disco started out with 4 members, and over time they slowly left. And by the time Death of a Bachelor came out, the entire band was gone and it was just Brendon Urie and the name. So this was basically his solo project. And he kept the name, and it was actually a success. Most people call it a concept album, where the concept, you know, when you think of concept albums, there's a clearly defined story. And a lot of the times people think, you know, you can make up your own story to the songs on this album. But Brendon Urie himself sort of said the concept is his own life. Hence the name Death of a Bachelor. He started Panic at the Disco when he was 16. And it's sort of been his whole life. And he got married right before writing this album. And a lot of it is going back and reflecting on his life before he got married. And, you know, how crazy it was to be a teenager, basically, touring around and just living the rock star life. So I highly recommend every song on this album. The first side of the album is very catering to stuff you can play, like in stadiums and on the radio. And as you get further into it, it gets sort of darker and like, oh, he's really writing from the heart, you know? And it's like, this is some Like, he really is growing up and he's growing mature. And it's not my favorite Panic the Disco album, but it really is up there as one of the top ones. They have a lot. And if you don't have this one in your collection, highly recommend a special anniversary one.
And finally today, I thought we'd take a spin through the wasteland with the one and only Neil Diamond. And this is also going to double as a Discogs quick tip, or maybe just an observation, if you will. Cataloging the other day, I went to go put this Neil Diamond Primitive picture disc in, billed as a limited edition picture disc from 1984. When I went into Discogs, though, to catalog this specific release, I noticed that there was another copy labeled as a mispress. Now, in Discogs terms, a mispress means that something was pressed incorrectly. But going into that Discogs mispress release, we now see that Judas Priest is tied into this mess. So that means that the Neil Diamond Primitive audio was actually accidentally pressed onto a Judas Priest picture disc. I just tried to picture that Judas Priest fan in 1984 getting all excited about their new picture disc, dropping a needle down, and hearing Neil Diamond.
Primitive. Yeah, that's how I feel when I look in your eyes. I feel primitive. Uncivilized. Like something from out of the heart of the jungle.
Thanks for watching The Record Show. If you haven't done so yet, please make sure to subscribe to the Radio Wasteland Records YouTube channel. And be sure to hit that notifications bell so you'll be alerted every time we upload new content.